Hi guys, Nick Jennison for Guitar Interactive, and on the test bench today, we're taking a look at the vintage V6 Thomas Blug signature guitar. I'm sure you all know who Thomas is, but if you don't, he's a very well-respected German guitar player and demonstrator and clinician, and he's also the mind behind the Blue Guitar Amp 1, which sort of started that whole pedalboard amp revolution that we've been seeing recently. And this is his signature instrument, and it's based on his favorite 1961 Strat, and it's distressed, as you can see, really looks the part, sounds fantastic, I'm sure you'll agree. We'll see more of that in a moment. In the intro, you heard me playing through all of the gain using all of the notes with our Victory VX100 Super Kraken. We're gonna go to a slightly less gained out sound and hear some more playing before we go any further, and then we'll talk about the spec. So aside from just sounding and looking the part, this guitar also has some really cool modern features that don't detract from the distinct vintage vibe, if you'll pardon the pun, that this guitar's got going on. Let's start at the headstock end and we'll take a tour of the spec. So starting at the headstock end, you can see we've got a classic six on a side headstock design, and that's great for string pull and also for balance. We've got a very discreet Thomas Blug signature up there at the top end, so there's no signature-itis going on here, but you can get with some guitars. If we flip it around, we've got Vintage's Wilkinson Easy Lock tuners, but they're in this fantastic aged kind of finish, and they look very authentic and they feel great under the hands, but more importantly, they're a locking design that also has a very classic aesthetic, which I think is great. You can also see where the aging process begins, because down here, right at the low portion of the neck, we've got some of the finish kind of sanded away, and there's a bit of dirt rubbed in there. This is how the guitar comes stock from the factory, and that continues all the way down the bottom of the neck as well, which is really nice. That's a very classy touch, and oftentimes this kind of dirtiness that comes with relict guitars is absent on more affordable models. You know, you'll find this thing where the paint's been taken away, but the wood looks clean, and it just doesn't look authentic. But this really, really looks like a played-in guitar and feels like one too. If we flip it back over, we've got a Graphtec graphite nut, which really helps with the trem. It's self-lubricating, it doesn't stick. It's really well cut, it's a very high quality part. And the fretboard, I'm assuming is rosewood. I couldn't actually find any information on this, but it looks like rosewood to me, and it certainly feels like rosewood. So if it's not, it's a very impressive alternative material. Definitely looks the part though. And it is a 7.5-inch radius, so it's ever so slightly a hair flatter than the typical classic Strat boards that you might have found, but it definitely has that vintage round feel, although this is offset by the fact that Trev Wilkinson and Thomas Blug have spec'd out this guitar with tall fat frets, which is a very common upgrade on old school Strats because it really helps with the playability, and it means you can retain that lovely round feel, but you still get this big nice kind of bending capability, and it feels great for faster legato lines too. Speaking of frets, there are 21 of them, which is probably my only criticism of this guitar. For my money, I don't think there's any trade-off in having a 22nd fret. I would have personally had one there, but it's not my signature guitar, it's Thomas Blug's signature guitar, so I'm guessing there's a reason why he has 21 frets. It could just be preference, but as a guitar player who's used to playing 22 fretboards, it does throw off my internal geography, so to speak. So if you flip it back around, You can see we've got this aged neck plate, which just helps add to the aesthetic. It's a four bolt design. There's no fancy heel carves going on or anything like that, but it's not a terribly blocky heel and doesn't get too much in the way when it comes to upper fret access. And you can see the back's being aged away. Again, a slight criticism here is that the same aging process that's been applied to the neck could have possibly been applied to these bare wood contours, but realistically, if you play this guitar for more than a couple of weeks, it's probably going to dirty up anyway, because that's what tends to happen to bare wood. So it's going to look better the more you play it. There are three springs in the trem claw, and this is a very pertinent point that we'll get to in a moment. It's the Wilkinson trem, which is a wonderful trem, but you'll notice that the trem layout is slightly strange. We've got one straight spring, one spring in the middle, and this one is off at an angle, and I'll explain exactly why it's set up that way when we come to play with the trem in just a moment. But we're going to flip it back over. Once again, fabulous aged white look to the body. I think this is probably one of my favorite looks for this type of guitar, that aged classic white with the kind of green yellow pickguard. And it's not over the top. It looks like an old instrument, but it doesn't look ludicrous. It just kind of looks nice. And again, this kind of bare wood here is going to dirty up nicely the more that you play this guitar, even though it looks a little bit clean right about now. And again, with the Wilkinson trem, we have aged saddles, which is a really nice touch, and it's that kind of bent steel saddle, which some players will argue has a better tone. I haven't done the experiment myself, so it's hard to say, but I know players who swear by these saddles over brass or more blocky steel type saddles. And we have an aged push-in trem arm, which is a very firm fit, which is quite difficult to get in and out, but once it's in there, it is in. And then aged plastic parts, Wilkinson proprietary pickups, which sound fantastic, and some very clever wiring that we'll talk about in a moment. It's your typical five-way switch, so you're going to get this pickup, these pickups, this pickup, these pickups, and this pickup, and as you'd expect, it's hum cancelling in positions 2 and 4, but these are not noiseless pickups. They are your traditional single coils with all of the hum that goes along with it. However, if we pop this pot down here, there's a little push-push on the second tone, and what that's going to do is bring in a dummy coil. Now, a dummy coil is essentially a pickup that's housed under the pickguard, but it's not wired in to actually detect the sound of the strings. It's actually just there to provide some hum cancelling capabilities. And it does ever so slightly affect the top end glassiness of the pickups, but the great thing about it is you can defeat it. So if you're in an environment like we're in today where noise isn't too much of a problem, you can leave the pickups in true single coil mode, but if you find yourself in a very noisy place, you can simply pop that out and you'll get maybe 95% of that beautiful tone without any of the hum. And even more clever, it automatically defeats the dummy coil in positions 2 and 4. So it means every position is hum cancelling. Now, in terms of wiring, we have a neck tone and a middle tone. So there's no bridge tone control, as you'd expect on some guitars like this. But the bridge pickup is warm and fat, and I don't think it really necessarily needs that bridge tone control mod, but it's an easy modification to perform if that's something you're into. And last but not least, we've got a treble bleed cap on the volume pot, which again is a really common mod. Loads of these kind of like things that Strat players have been doing to their guitars over the decades have been implemented on this guitar, just kind of out with the box, which is great. It's really a testament to the wisdom of Thomas Blug as an experienced Strat player and Trev Wilkinson as a builder. Now, I said we're going to talk about the trem, and the reason why the springs are the way they are is because it's set up to bend up in perfect intervals, which is rather cool. What we essentially have, if we play the low E string and pull the trem up to the very far reach of its upward travel, we're going to get a minor third or a 3-fret interval. We're going to get a major second or a 2-fret interval on the A and D strings. The G string gives us a minor third interval, which again is a 3-fret interval. We get a 2-fret interval on the B string and a 1-fret interval on the high E. And these are pretty close to bang on, which is really impressive straight out of the box. Allow me to demonstrate. So very quickly, if we take the low E string, playing this 3rd fret note and bending up should yield us the 6th fret note like this. And it's pretty close to bang on. And that's with no finessing on my part. I'm just pulling the trem until it stops. Same here. Now, these intervals are more reliable on the treble strings because that's really where you're going to get the benefit. And the A string is slightly off, just by comparison. It's ever so slightly sharp, but it's really the treble strings where this is going to become a thing. And I'm sure you can already think of many, many musical uses for this kind of like intervallic trem pulling, if you want to call it that. Not least of which is the ability to play chords, or fractional chords at least, on the treble strings like this. And that's a trick that strat players like Carl Verheyen have been doing to their trems forever and a day, and it's really rather useful, especially for faux pedal steel type playing. Now, we've done a little bit of talk about the specifications, or rather quite a lot of talk about the specifications. Let's do a tour of the tones, and we're going to begin with all of the straight up single coil non-hum cancelling tones. We're going to go to a clean sound, and I'll give you a quick tour of the five positions. So all five pickup selections are balanced with lots of chime and clarity on the high end, but no ice picky harshness to speak of, which is really nice. Sometimes that's quite difficult to get right without using the tone controls to balance that out. But in this case, with both tone controls wide open and indeed no tone control in the bridge pickup, everything sounds clear and very strat-like, but also quite warm, and it's not unpleasant on the top end at all. Let's do another quick tour with a medium gain sound, and I'm also going to demonstrate the treble bleed capacitor, which is going to allow us to clean the guitar up without losing top end. So as you can hear, the character of these pickups translate really well through this low to medium gain kind of sound. And of course, the treble bleed capacitor is going to allow us to clean the guitar up without losing too much high end. So if you're a single channel amp kind of player, this is going to be right up your street. Now, the next thing for us to try is some situational type applications for this guitar. And the first thing we're going to see is how well it deals as a funk guitar. So positions 2 and 4 have all of that fantastic, quacky, out of phase character that you really need for this kind of style. Now, the next thing we're going to explore is how well this guitar deals as a modern blues instrument. And for that, we're going to get some Hendrix style chord melody things on the go with a medium gain sound. And going further down that road, let's explore the same kind of sound, but this time with some slide. So the warm 60s inspired voice that we've got going on in this guitar really flatters that kind of slide playing, especially in my favorite slide position, which is position 2 with the middle pickup tone rolled all the way off. And it sounds fantastically vocal and almost horn-like. So anyway, the last application I want to try is to see how well this guitar deals as an out and out rock machine. So we're going to pile loads of gain on. I'm also going to explore the difference that this push-push dummy coil makes, they call it the Bucker switch, this push-push dummy coil makes to our noise levels. So we'll experiment with that first and then we'll do some high gain playing. So with this slightly more raucous setting, the dummy coil really comes in handy, not just for taming that noise, but also for taking a slight bit of the high treble out of the sound. It just warms things up a teeny tiny bit, almost like having a tone pot wired into the bridge pickup. And it's perfect for both blues rock inspired lines and also some more Swedish antics, if you know what I'm talking about. Anyway, guys, this is the vintage V6 Thomas Blug signature guitar. It's a very impressive instrument at an incredibly impressive price point. Had a lot of fun playing this one. It's right up my street. I really like the way it looks. I like the way it sounds, like the way it plays. Very highly recommended. My name is Nick Jennison for Guitar Interactive. I will see you next time. Thanks for checking out this video on the Guitar Interactive YouTube channel. We really do appreciate it. Drop us a comment below and let us know what you liked and what you think we should cover in the future. And check out these links here for more great content. We are, of course, your home for all things gear related. And we have killer interviews and tuition and all manner of stuff coming up for you in the near future. So hit that subscribe button down there. Make sure you hit the notification icon too so we can keep you up to date with the latest and greatest news on all things guitar.